Today we're going to be looking at plants. Now plants are incredible things. At some point you've probably relied on a plant yourself, and it doesn't matter what corner of the globe you live in, chances are you're likely to encounter a plant. Some plants are big, some plants are small, some plants appear near the coast, some inland, some appear in the middle of nowhere. And all of these plants share a similar story, because every single plant needs fuel. Some use coal, some use...
Coal?
Yeah.
Coal. Gardening plants. It's a gardening show.
Oh.
Which one's all right here?
I suppose that's that ruined. Hello and welcome to another episode of Embrace Your Outdoor Space. My name's Tommy Cross, and in this episode we get to indulge in one of my favourite pastimes in the garden, and that is mowing. Or we were going to be mowing until the weather went all British. It's been about as decisive as my children at dinner time, the weather recently. It's April, but we've had sleet, we've had snow, we've had rain, we've had wind, we've had the occasional pocket of sunshine, but what it means is that we get to fall back onto one of my other favourite jobs in the garden, and that is planting. There's something wonderfully therapeutic about planting. As a gardener, it's when we become in tune with our outdoor space, and we get to dress it a bit like a painter preparing his canvas in the winter months, digging, turning over our beds and borders up against the elements, all that mud, sweat and tears. It's time for it to start. Can it make any more noise? It's a fledgling being fed, isn't it? Where's that sparrowhawk? Most importantly, we're improving the environment for the population of pollinators. Now, we really want to be rolling out the red carpet, the lavender carpet, the pink carpet, the orange carpet, you get the idea. We want these guys coming in, and we want to make sure they get the best welcome possible. Now, we're gonna focus specifically on pots, and the reason why we're doing that is because we get to own the environment of the pots. Whereas our beds and borders are full of soil, which is great, chances are we don't know what the soil is. We don't know whether it's clay, we don't know whether it's limey, we don't know whether it's alkaline, and we've also got to contend with other variables as well. So we are taking control and restricting all those variables. But first thing you need to do is choose the pot and choose the pollinator that you want to plant in your garden. In this episode, we are going to focus on one of my favorites. I think it's most gardeners' favorites, to be honest, and that's lavender. Now, when it comes to lavender, there are plenty of varieties to choose from, but all of them are going to give you the same wonderful properties, that soft, tactile foliage with those plumes of lavender and that rich aroma. Now, the front here, I've got some French lavender. Very nice. Very good job, France. But it's no match. No match for Lavender Heathcott, otherwise known as Her Majesty's English Lavender. God save our Great. English lavender, you'll see, has a much kind of softer look to it, slightly leggier and longer. And there's a reason why we're planting it into a much larger pot, and that is because this small plant, when it's happy, will become this larger plant here. So we want to make sure that we put it into a plant which is large enough to accommodate it. Oh, and to our French viewers for the earlier reference, je suis désolé, pour moi en général, je suis un idiot. Avec le fromage. First thing we need to do is remember what the important part of the plant is, and that is the root system. You've heard me rustling on about this in a previous video. This is the engine room of the plants. We want to make sure this is going into the right growing medium. Lavender likes free draining soil, and it loves a sunny spot. And there's a reason I'm choosing a ceramic pot. It's because I think firstly, you can't beat the aesthetic. It also offers up some insulation properties as well against frost. Now, I mentioned we've had rain and we've had wind and we've had cold here. We've also had some severe frosts all the way through April. So the last thing we want to do when we're potting out is to put them out too early and risk the scope of frost. So if I do get cold temperatures, that ceramic pot will offer up some insulation against those late frosts. But we need to make sure we fill our pots up properly. There's no point just lobbing in a lot of soil or compost, in particular soil actually. A lot of us get off to the wrong start because the growing medium is incorrect and we want to layer it up. There's a little bit of science when it comes to filling your pots up, in particular with lavender as well, because it does like free draining soil. If you've got a long deep pot like this, if you're then going to fill this up top to bottom with compost, you are going to spend a lot of money filling your pots up. It's also going to make it very difficult to move around the garden. Perhaps if you want to move pot into a sunnier spot throughout the midst of summer, picking that up when it's fully laden with soil is going to be quite a task. The other thing as well is it's also going to inhibit drainage as well. We want the moisture to be retained in the compost, but we won't want it to be too thick with water. So in order to fill this pot up, what we could do is use aggregate or broken pots, as they used to do back in the Victorian times. But in the Victorian times, they didn't have something else, polystyrene. There's a lot of this in around the home. Every time you have a delivery, it tends to be wrapped in polystyrene. Now, a good thing about this is it's incredibly lightweight, incredibly easy to break up, makes little to no mess. And the other thing is, it stops us sending it to landfill as well. So we're doing two or three jobs here. We're making our life easier. We're saving ourselves some money. And we're reusing something which was destined for the tip and bin. These air pockets are gonna keep the oxygen in the compost and allow the moisture to drain through. So once we've got our base layer of polystyrene, let's just pack that down nice and easy. We can add a little bit of aggregate just to fill the smaller pockets. Now it doesn't need to be anything particular at all, it just needs to be a clean aggregate. So in this case, I've got 10 mil aggregate. Just gonna fill a few of those holes up to make sure that when I put my compost in, it's not gonna fall all the way down to the bottom. So, that's one thing my wife loves is when I steal her best mixing bowls in order to mix compost. But this is the recipe for success, because you want to make sure your compost is well balanced. You want to make sure it's free draining. Lavender likes stony soil, and all I've done to my conventional shop bought compost is add a few stones in. You could add horticultural grit. If you haven't got horticultural grit to hand, don't worry, you can just use some clean aggregate. Remember, it's all about making sure that our plant gets the best start possible. So then that goes into your pot. So what I tend to do is add a base layer and then a couple more tricks to show you. Same process, I've got my polystyrene at the bottom, then I've added my compost, and I'm gonna add a little bit of gravel into my compost. And then, instead of planting that straight in, what I want you to do, take the pot, pot it in, and then we're going to fill around that with compost, because I mentioned I'm going to bring a few pals over, some of the pollinator pals. Front and center, in the middle, I want my lavender, and around the peripheries, I'm going to put things like trailing lobelia, I'm going to put some campanula, I'm going to put some trailing petunias as well, so I get that vertical plume of that wonderful lavender and all that aroma, and then spilling out around the outside edges. I've still got color cascading over the side. Once our pot's in place, we know exactly how low that root system is going to sit. So you want the soil level to be the same height as the root system you've removed from the plant. And that allows us then to flesh out the edges and get our smaller plants in first before we put the pièce de résistance in the center. You can use a trowel, but I love using my hands. Don't be afraid to make a mess either. This is acceptable. I know we're making a video, but we're making it warts and all. You can make a mess in your garden. It's the joys of gardening. So we've got our soil in around the peripheries of our pot. You can see that stone in there. Those stones are creating oxygen pockets and allowing the moisture to drain through, as we mentioned previously. Now, and I said I'm going to bring along a few pals. So in here, I've got some trailing lobelia. Same process again. Just give the roots a little bit of a gentle stroke. And our trailing plants, we want to position around the edges. And there are, again, there's another little rule of thumb as well, which is, most gardeners will tell you, things work best in odd numbers. I think there's something to do with the way the brain works, that we find odd numbers more pleasing in the garden. The other thing we want to do as well is avoid overcrowding the plant pot itself. We want to make sure that everything's got space to breathe and live. So we've got a bit of balance. We're going to add another one on the other side here. Make sure the soil line is the line of the top of the root system. We don't want to overfill that. We don't want to trap any of the foliage underneath the soil or the compost, because that will start causing the plant to rot. Okay, so either side, flanking, we've got these pillows of purple. Then we're going to get this kind of cerise purple, almost. Let's go for one here, shall we? Just pop him in. Oh, completely different plant here. A bit of a schoolboy error there. Very, very similar. One's the bilia, and one trailing petunia. Doesn't mean it can't go in. I can go straight in over on this side as well. All of these plants will look fantastic together with like wonderful tones of pinks, purples, but also that trailing tendency as well. It's all going to fill out these peripheries here. So we've got four. I mentioned that odd numbers work well. What else do we add? I think we can add a bit of campanula to underdress. We give it an underskirt of that lovely purple as well. And when it comes to pollinators, campanula is a real friend to the bees and butterflies. It creates almost like a low-growing blanket of purple. So see, this is what gardening should be. This is where you should give yourself time to enjoy doing the task. Turn the phone off, turn the TV off. Your garden should be a reflection of you. So if you like something, give it a go. If it doesn't work one year, you can always swap it out next year. Artistic license is up to you in terms of the color palette that you want to see. Except if you are planting lavender, it only comes in lavender color, I'm afraid. All these little pockets from the outside. It's essential that when you're planting, if you're talking to everybody, your voice goes up high at the end. Plant these around the outside. Become a different person when I'm planting. In fact, I could happily do this all day, every day. It's one of those moments where you get to relax and you actually achieve something as well. I think there's always that sense of satisfaction when you've achieved something. Doesn't matter how big or how small your pots are, there's always that sense of accomplishment that you did this, and then you get to see it thrive throughout the summer months as well. So this is just the start of the journey. Everything you see here is going to start growing, and as it grows, it's going to put more of a show on, and so attract more of those wonderful pollinators into the garden. So why do we leave that pot in? Well, it means that we can get our smaller plants in, get them in firmly and securely. And now we can bring in the centerpiece. We've already, remember, given our root system a little tickle. Don't put that in. Told you I was a different person. Told you, different person when I plant up. Remove the pot. And now he's got space to take the center stage. And there you have it. One free draining pollinator pot. Stick this in a sunny spot. Spring and summer months, everything is gonna start developing. Now, obviously we don't want our lavender to get too big, so we don't want it to dominate and take over these peripheral plants. So the easiest way to do a little bit of routine maintenance is just go right down to the bottom here and remove individual stems. So if it does start sprouting out and start dominating the pot, right at the bottom here. And if it is in flower, you can keep that. You can dry it, bundle it up, or you can press it and get all those wonderful oils out as well. Well, that's just one pot of pollinators and one plant that we've looked at. And there's plenty to go at. You're almost spoilt for choice as a gardener. A lot of it depends on what you can get your hands on and personal preference, but you're free to be as artistic and creative as you like when you get home. And there's a few others I wanted to show you as well, because it's all very well us talking about lavender, but if you don't like lavender, and some people don't, then what else can you go for? Well, let's start bottom to top. Here we've got Cape Daisy or Osteospermum. Again, a variety of different colors. And we look at this kind of almost psychedelic look. Those strong yellows on the outside, you know, those rich magentas and purples in the center here, and the whites. And the thing I love about this is this plant changes throughout the course of the day. In the summer, it will burst open, it will show off everything it's got. And then my children say that the fairies come along at night and close it all up, because that plant will open up and then close over the course of the day. So almost gonna react to the sunlight. Then we've got Callistemon here, which is a really odd looking plant. You'll see this in much hotter climes, just growing naturally. It's called bottle brush. My kids call it the toilet brush tree. The bees will flock to this. This is a bit more of a shrub. So if you've got larger spaces in your beds and borders or bigger pots, you can also get these grown as a standard as well. They really do stop you in your tracks, because very unusual foliage and vibrant flowers as well. On the other side here, we've got our dahlias. The good thing about dahlias, there's plenty of choice when it comes to color, size. These are dwarf. Some will grow incredible heights and they'll grow throughout the whole course of the summer, all the way through to the bitter end of summer. Nemesia, I'm slightly obsessed with Nemesia this year. This is great for low growing color. Again, puts up loads of flowers and is a wonderful lure to those pollinators, the butterflies and the bees. Again, you can create whole carpets of low growing color with this plant, and a variety of different colors to go at as well. We've got our Lobelia, we've got our Campanula, which we've talked about. And then we've got little plants for little gardens, slightly shadier gardens as well. This is Saxifrage, which will put out a little flowery show of its own. These work great in things like succulent gardens, in amongst the sedums. They've got very delicate flowers, part of the alpine family, but they're again, great stop off for those wandering bees if they need something in a garden which doesn't get the most sunshine. These will still put out a flowery show for you. From something small to something not so small, and when these flower, these can flower in gigantic stature as well. Now, it's not flowering now, this is a lupin. I love the foliage on this. Firstly, it catches the dew in the morning and just rests on the top of these waxy leaves. In fact, there's some of it here from the rainfall earlier. So Again, it has a really aesthetic property just from the foliage, but when the flower comes out, my goodness, it comes out with a bang. These conical trumpets of plenty of flowers. It's a shame we haven't got one in flower, but it's just a little bit too early for it now. I love it, the bees love it, the butterflies love it, and it's a great way to fill up generous beds and borders. Put this alongside things like delphiniums or some low-growing foliage, maybe some low-growing campania or lobelia, and this will really give your beds and borders a real wash of color and pollinators throughout the summer months. When it comes to vertical flowering plants, ceanothus is a really good one. This likes well-drained, but moist soil. You can put this in some really sunny spots as well. You can grow this up against walls, up against fences, and you can just see it's just going over now, but this comes out again with these kind of lavender dark blues, and very, very easy to plant, very, very easy to look after. Just give it routine watering during dry months and a bit of feed now and again, and this pretty much looks after itself.
I'm the germinator. Ah.
Okay. Well, the virtue of gardening and having a garden or space anywhere outside, it could be a balcony, it could be a terrace, is the fact that we get to dress it up high, down low. And if you want to dress up high and add some pollinators at height, my terribly short Tyrannosaurus Rex arms almost let me down there, but you can hang some hanging baskets. Now, routine watering is essential for your hanging baskets. Remember, these guys are in a confined space. You can go for a mix of different plants, things like your pansies, petunias, or you can just go for a single plant. In this case, we've got some fuchsia, trailing fuchsia, which is gonna drop down. It's gonna shower color and flowers all the way down and over and overspill with these wonderful heads of purples and pinks. Again, bees and butterflies are gonna be drawn to those. And it's another way of getting color and pollinators into your garden without taking up precious space. Now, I set my friends and family a challenge in the run-up to this video. They had to renew their outdoor space, but they were only allowed to use recycled or repurposed materials. So let's have a look at the gallery of upcycled pots and planters. We've got Wellies by Wren, aged 3.5. Slightly more contemporary from my wife. Her inspiration for these was bean cans, because that's what they are, they're old bean cans. That planter was constructed by Grandad Cross at a princely sum of one pack of screws and two pallets. Making some room for some planting up high is the work of Peter on site, age 6 and 20 years. So this is my son's inspiration. He took the blanket of Campanula quite literally to create a flower bed. There's an interesting use of height here, and this is by Paul, who's 9 and 20 years. And Paul said he was inspired by the scaffolding board that he managed to find in my skip and the traffic lights that made him late for filming today.
I like it.
So that's one pot down with one plant featured in just one video, but we'll be making a whole series of videos on these prolific pollinators throughout the course of the spring and summer months. If you've enjoyed today's video, you can always leave us a message below. And if you've got a horticultural headache going on at home, don't forget you can always shout out for a few tips and ideas as to how to get the best out of your outdoor space over the course of the summer months. As always, if you want extra information, check the link at the end of the video, and hopefully you'll catch us on our next installment of Embrace Your Outdoor Space. Thanks for watching.